Do you know how the service locator pattern got its bad reputation? Some people used it where it doesn't belong, that's how. I will now show you how to stay on the safe side and enjoy what's good in it. Let's start simple. This class is a service that executes within the .NET generic host. Generic host supports dependency injection. A service locator hides deep under its surface, but you should not worry about that. I have just asked for a logger, and the generic host will gladly pass one during the construction of this object. This will work like a charm because the dependency injection framework resolves the dependencies upon request. The generic host is using the logger too, so it has configured it already. Something like this. The dependency injection framework will now resolve the logger when calling the constructor of console-hosted service that needs it. The generic host is then built and eventually run. Where is the service locator here? Oh, you have to make your hands dirty to find it. The built-in dependency injection framework uses a service locator on the inside. This provider is of the type I service provider, that is the service locator used privately by the dependency injection framework. That is a usual practice in dependency injection. Is this a service locator for you too? That is the trick question. For example, I can use it to resolve the logger. That gives you a glimpse of the generic service locator as it is being used inside the dependency injection framework. Of course, my factory function must produce what it was asked. This factory function uses the generic service locator because it cannot guess in advance what services I plan to request. That is essentially the only valid use of the service locator pattern. This resolution process hides behind the dependency injection configuration. You will only see it in situations where the dependency injection cannot instantiate your classes by just passing objects to the constructor. Unless you write a general library, the best service locator for you is the one you do not depend on. Let it remain as a private implementation detail of the library we used. Here is the custom class that benefits from its existence but never sees it. I can ask for more dependencies. Isn't this beautiful? Well, no, not entirely. This, which I have just done, leads us to the dark side of the service locator. Let me run the program and you will see what it does. Here it crashes. It crashes with the error that says unable to resolve service for type I books repository. That is where the greatest benefit of the service locator meets its greatest peril. The service locator that hides behind this dependency injection framework does not depend on any class. And yet it instantiates each of them. How can that be? As I said, that is where its greatest benefit meets its peril. If I didn't set up the type mappings, the service locator that sits behind this dependency injection would fail at runtime. The service locator removes dependencies at compile time at the expense of potentially failing at runtime if not dynamically fed with the correct type data. It essentially turns compile time dependencies into runtime dependencies. I expect my service to work correctly now. I plan to use the data source to query all the books from the database. Then I use the domain model, which is well known to me, to isolate the books that have not been published yet. I'm logging some information about those books, and that is all. Where is the dependency injection framework? Where is the dreaded service locator? As far as my custom code is concerned, they might as well not exist. That is what's good about these two. But then there comes the antagonist. What would the programming be like if we never made costly mistakes? You don't have to learn the domain model from this project. I will tell you what each element does in this method. I plan to schedule publishing for the unpublished books in 1 week from now. The full source code is available on my Patreon page. Every patron helps hundreds of other viewers watch the videos on my channel for free. Become a patron and get access to all the source code from this and all other videos on my channel. Then comes the critical domain operation. Every book is associated with a publisher. Different publishers operate in different countries. Scheduling a book for publishing may be a complex process. I have no freaking idea how to schedule the publishing of a book. But don't worry, there is a service for that. The publishing services interface is designed to help publish books. Don't worry, it is very simple. This object model includes publishing services. The publisher object tells which company is publishing the book. You can start from that object and obtain an appropriate service that helps in publishing. For example, this publishing service object could be specific to one country, observing the local laws and important dates in that country. For example, it might track the dates of book fairs and optimize releasing a book for a fair. Publishing is a complex business. I am more than happy to pass it the book and the desired date and let it do the magic without my further intervention. Let me run the application. You can see that all the books are planned. They may have been scheduled by different publishing instances, but the end results seem complete after all. Do you see what I did here? Many programmers would not even see that this code is using the service locator pattern. You see, I am using an object that locates a service appropriate for the operation at hand. That is the service locator by definition. It doesn't need to be generic. This service locator is non-generic, but it is polymorphic. It may return different instances implementing the same interface. A question that always pops up is whether the service locator will fail. That is a giant drawback of any design of this kind. Let me show you what I mean. What if I asked for an actual publishing service? The difference is immense. The only failure mode for this design happens before this object is constructed. There is an old principle which I keep repeating. If you have an object, it's fine. This object would never be created if there were no object of type publishing. If I found myself in the middle of an instance level method, then I already possess the publishing service and I am free to use it. There is no other possibility, you see. Then comes the second important principle of working with dependencies. You can design the dependency so that it accepts all the data at once, not one object at a time. Why do I prefer this design over the one below? It's about performance, believe it or not. I don't bother optimizing code ahead of time, but on the other hand, I don't make obvious blunders. I know this call will execute within acceptable time limits. If there were a performance issue, someone would notice and I would go and optimize this schedule all method or whatever hides behind it. How about the service locator call in the loop? It produces an unknown delay. We don't know how costly it is. It could require a database call or a network call. That could cost anything from nanoseconds to dozens of milliseconds. Worse yet, it happens inside the loop. How do we fix a performance problem when it happens? I don't know. Honestly, I don't know. I'm stuck with a call in a loop. I don't do miracles at work, you know. This method shows the critical distinction between using a service locator and using a common dependency service. The first case is that of a dependency. We know it will always be present if the method was called. It also enforces the single responsibility principle and separation of concerns. Whatever concern there is, it is either in this method or in that dependency's method. Not in both places. How about the second variant based on the service locator? It is obviously prone to runtime failures. Having this method called is no guarantee that it will complete. That is the technical difficulty you must account for. There is also the substantial difficulty that has to do with software design. We find the same concern in two places now. That will sooner or later cause trouble. This variant is what gives service locator a bad name. The variant based on a common dependency is cleaner in several critical ways. It is simple to set up, safer to run, and easier to maintain should the trouble arise later. I would now suggest you learn more about dependency injection and other principles of good design.